Greetings and welcome to the legend of Catfish and Little Brim. This is a story about a big fish in a little pond in the south. He becomes bored with life in the little pond, so he sets out on a great adventure to the north. Along the way, he comes to realize what is truly important in life. This story was written by Ronnie Wells of Salado, Texas. The story is read by Ms. Julie Brunet, who is a teacher in Lafayette, Louisiana. In fact, she liked the story so much that she even wrote a song and a play about Catfish and Little Brim. And now here's Miss Brunet to tell you the legend of Catfish and Little Brim.
Chapter 1, A Big Fish in a Little Pond. Long, long ago, in a small pond surrounded by beautiful weeping willows and covered with lily pads, there lived Catfish and his best friend Little Brim. Catfish was a kindly fellow with dark, shiny skin, long, curling whiskers, and a pudgy white belly. Being rather large, he generally swam with his head down, slowly fanning his tail back and forth while grunting softly to himself. Little Brim was always smiling and cheerful. Each day he delighted in pond life. He had a reddish complexion with large freckles on his nose. Always moving around, he darted here and there, blowing bubbles and sometimes jumping out of the water to make a splash. One day, as Catfish and Little Brim were out for their usual swim, Little Brim noticed that Catfish didn't seem to be himself. Catfish had become bored with pond life, and it was starting to show.
"Hey, Catfish, watch this," bubbled Little Brim. He proceeded to swim round and round in little circles and then suddenly leaped out of the water.
Catfish had always enjoyed Little Brim's playfulness, but this time he only smiled half-heartedly and said nothing.
"What's bothering you, Catfish?"
asked Little Brim.
"You're not yourself."
"It's life in this little pond," replied Catfish. "I've lived here all my life and nothing exciting ever happens. It's the same old thing, day in and day out. Just once I would like to journey to new places and see new things."
"Catfish, why don't we go and visit Bullfrog?"
"To hear him talk, you'd think he's been everywhere and seen everything. And you do enjoy his conversations and stories. Perhaps he'll know how to cheer you up," Little Brim said, trying to be helpful. Catfish agreed to visit Bullfrog, but he wasn't very excited about it. "I doubt if Bullfrog could ever understand how I feel. With his long, muscular legs, he's able to hop anywhere he pleases and go anywhere he wants to go. Remember, he even lived in a large lake up north before coming to our pond," Catfish pointed out.
"No, I remember Bullfrog's tales of large fish with bad manners who were even bigger than you, Catfish,"
Little Brim noted. "Well, I doubt that," Catfish replied, as he smiled to himself at the mere thought of any fish being larger than him.
"There's Bullfrog!" exclaimed Little Brim.
And there he was, the frog of all frogs, stretched out on a big lily pad, catching a few rays. What a dashing figure he was with his most handsome physique. You see, Bullfrog had tiny arms and a big belly, but he also had long muscular legs and was able to hop great distances. He was a wise old boy, a philosopher, if you will, and he seemed to have an answer for everything. With his deep, rumbling voice and laid-back manner, Bullfrog made quite an impression on everyone who knew him. In truth, it was Bullfrog's tall tales that first got Catfish thinking of traveling to other places.
"Good morning, friends. How are you on this fine day?" bellowed Bullfrog.
"I'm well," replied Little Brim, "but Catfish is bored with life in our little pond."
"But why?"
Bullfrog asked. "Our pond life isn't very exciting," replied Catfish. "I long to see the world. I want to visit faraway places such as the northern lake where you used to live."
Catfish, Little Brim chimed in. All of your friends are here, and you are the biggest fish in the whole pond.
None of that matters anymore. If I could hop like you, Bullfrog, I could live anywhere I wanted. I would hop to that big lake and try living there. But because I'm a fish, I'm stuck here forever, Catfish said with sadness in his voice. Bullfrog tried to scratch the top of his head with one of his short arms.
Catfish, Little Brim may be right. You might not like it in a big lake. It's quite different from our little pond. But if you are really serious about leaving, I might be able to help.
Really? Tell me how, shouted Catfish. Tell me how.
No, you must be patient. Now leave me alone so I can take a nap and give this some more thought. Come back tomorrow, and I shall have an answer for you,
Bullfrog said. He then stretched out on his lily pad, put his arms behind his head, crossed his legs, and went to sleep. Somewhat frustrated, Catfish swam away with Little Brim following close behind. The rest of the day, Little Brim tried to interest Catfish in their old familiar surroundings, but Catfish wasn't interested. He could think of nothing else but leaving the pond. Since nothing he did or said seemed to change Catfish's mind about leaving, Little Brim swam away with a heavy heart, worrying about his unhappy friend and how lonely he would be if Catfish were gone.
Chapter 2. Leaving Home.
The next afternoon arrived all too quickly for Little Brim. Catfish came by, and together they swam off to see Bullfrog. They hardly spoke as they neared his lily pad. Catfish and Little Brim heard a loud shout from Bullfrog as they approached.
By golly, fellows, I've got it! Catfish, Little Brim, I want you to meet my cousins, the tree frogs,
Bullfrog said, pointing to a whole slew of little frogs in the willow tree just behind him.
Now listen closely, guys, and I'll tell you my plan. But first, you need to hear this story,
Bullfrog said.
At a family reunion a few years back, something happened that had never happened before. When our family gets together, we like to sing and dance. Whenever the tree frogs sing and dance, it usually rains. Now, at our reunion, the more we sang and danced, the more it rained. The more it rained, the higher the water level rose in our little pond. It rose so high that for the first time ever, water began to run over the dam. You see, Catfish, I have hopped all over this country, and I know that the floodwaters lead into a small stream, which runs into a larger creek and eventually empties into the big river, said Bullfrog. Once you get to the river, you can go anywhere you want. Go south, and you will end up in the ocean. Go north, and you can go to the Great Lakes. But if I were you, I would go north, because the ocean has salt in the water, which will burn your gills.
Catfish could not believe what he was hearing. Could there actually be a possibility of leaving the little pond? At this point, Bullfrog called out to his cousins, who hopped down from the tree onto the lily pads all around him.
All right, start singing and dancing, shouted Catfish.
All of the tree frogs, with their bright green skin, big bulging eyes, and large hands and feet with suction cups, began to sing at the top of their voices. Then, lo and behold, it started to rain. The frogs all sang and danced the rain dance until it was raining like it had never rained before. The water got deeper and deeper. Finally, in the wee hours of the morning, water began to trickle over the dam. At first, it was only a tiny stream, but it grew deeper and wider until Catfish knew he would soon have his chance.
Now, remember, Catfish, the dam is very steep, and once you go over, you can't come back. Be sure that this is what you really want to do. If you must go, go now, urged Bullfrog. My cousins are getting tired and can't keep singing and dancing much longer.
Catfish and Little Brim looked at each other. Little Brim knew he had to be strong and not hold Catfish back from his dreams.
Catfish, you are my very best friend, and I want you to be happy. So go out and see the world, said Little Brim.
With that encouragement, Catfish darted over the dam, tumbling straight down through the rushing water. The current pushed him along at a rapid pace until he reached the small stream. Overcome with great joy and enthusiasm, he began to swim as fast as he could. Suddenly, he saw the entrance to the large creek. Catfish slowed down and cautiously approached the strange water of the creek. For the first time in his life, he was a little unsure of himself. What would the creek be like? Who lived there? And how long would it take to get to the river? As he continued on with caution, the morning sun seemed to melt away his doubts. His enthusiasm returned.
I'm free! I'm free! I can go anywhere! Sang Catfish as he rounded the bend and made his way into the big river.
He swam headlong into the murky waters of the Mississippi River, then proceeded north toward the Great Lakes. The excitement was overwhelming. He had never been in water so deep and so dark. Preferring to live near the bottom, Catfish lowered his head and swam to the depths of the river. Chapter 3. Adventure in the Big River. Catfish swam against the strong current as he moved further and further north in the unfamiliar water. Smaller fish scattered as he approached them.
Hey, how are you?
Catfish shouted in a friendly voice. The fish either swam off in a flash or just ignored him completely. Then, without warning and out of nowhere, a large fish passed by him in a big hurry. This was the first time in his life that he had ever seen a fish larger than himself. Intrigued, Catfish decided to make friends with this overgrown fellow.
What's your name, and why are you in such a hurry?
Shouted Catfish. The large fish slowed down for just a moment.
Carp, I a carp, and you had better swim for your life. Alligator Gar is coming,
he said in a panic. Catfish was so confused. He had just seen what he thought to be the largest fish in the world, and something was chasing it. How could this be? Then, out of the corner of his eye, Catfish saw a huge shadow moving in his direction. Looking up, he saw the reason the big fish was in such a panic. With his long snout exposing rows of sharp teeth, Alligator Gar was a terrifying sight. Catfish had only one chance. He dove under a large log on the bottom of the river. Too scared to move, he kept his head down as the gigantic fish passed overhead. With his heart pounding, Catfish now realized that Bullfrog was right about life outside the pond. He hid under the log for the rest of the day and night, thinking of his friends and wondering if he had made a serious mistake. As morning's light found its way deep into the river, Catfish's courage returned. He resumed his journey to the north, and as he did, he counted himself fortunate that he was able to escape the jaws of Alligator Gar. For reasons he could not explain, Catfish sensed that someone was watching over him, keeping him safe from harm. As he swam northward, Catfish made a few acquaintances along the way. A bass named Sam and a drum named Gasper Goo. Mr. Goo had lived in Lake Michigan for a short while and had known Bullfrog during that time. A friendly and talkative fellow, Mr. Goo gladly gave Catfish directions to the big lake. Catfish thanked him, said goodbye, and swam north with a greater sense of purpose. Each new day brought Catfish closer to his journey's end. He knew that he would never choose to settle in the river. River life, with its dark water and large, scary fish, held too many dangers. But lake life would be wonderful. New friends, new sights, and exciting new adventures were surely waiting for him. At long last, Catfish entered the waters of the lake. His eyes gazed into the clear, sparkling waters filled with fish of many different shapes and colors. The joy with which Catfish entered the lake didn't last long. Although it was beautiful, the lake was not home. Catfish's thoughts soon turned to life in the little pond with his friends. He tried hard to forget the old place and to be content with his new life in the big lake, but he just couldn't. A couple of lake locals, Willie Walleye and Pondexter Pike, took notice of Catfish and his sad situation. Amazed that he had journeyed all the way from a small southern pond, they tried to make him feel at home. But Catfish didn't feel at home. He was homesick. And so he swam aimlessly through the lake, day after day, imagining that he was home with Little Brim and Bullfrog. Chapter 4. Where there's a will, there's a way. Meanwhile, back at the little pond, autumn was in the air, and the willow trees were dressed in vivid colors of yellow and gold. As the wind blew their long, graceful limbs back and forth, the falling leaves sprinkled like specks of gold across the blue waters of the pond. As beautiful as it was during the fall, however, Little Brim was still feeling sad because he missed his friend Catfish. Every chance he got, he sought the advice and comfort of old Bullfrog. This day, as usual, he was on his way for a visit. As he came in sight of Bullfrog's lily pad, he spotted a strange frog in Bullfrog's place.
"Hey, what are you doing on Bullfrog's pad?"
Little Brim asked. The frog slowly opened one eye and yawned.
"Where is Bullfrog?"
Little Brim asked again.
"Well, he had to leave in a hurry last night. He said something about going up north to a lake he used to live in. He asked me to tell you that he'll return as soon as possible."
Little Brim was very unhappy to hear this shocking news. Now it seemed that he had lost both of his best friends.
"What if Bullfrog never comes home again?"
he wondered. He figured that the only way he would ever see his friends again was to leave the pond and go north to find them.
"That's what I'll do,"
thought Little Brim.
"No
matter how much I love my home, it's just not the same without my friends. I must find the tree frogs and get them to sing and do the rain dance. Then over the dam I will swim to find my friends." Back at the big lake, the waters glowed with the warm, radiant colors of the sunset. Catfish watched the brilliant display through eyes filled with tears. He wondered if Little Brim and Bullfrog were watching the same sunset back at the little pond. He missed his friends a lot. Overcome with sadness, he blurted out,
"I miss you, Little Brim. I miss you, Bullfrog."
Then, from only a short distance away, he heard a familiar voice.
"Did someone call my name?"
the deep voice asked. Catfish couldn't believe his ears.
Could it be? Could it actually be Bullfrog?
He swam as fast as he could in the direction of the voice.
"Is that you, Bullfrog? Is that really you?"
Bullfrog sat up on a lily pad and leaned over to greet Catfish.
"Well, how in the world are you, Catfish? How do you like living in the lake?"
"Well, it's not what I thought it would be. Bullfrog, I'm so glad to see you. What are you doing here? How is Little Brim and everyone back at the pond?
Catfish asked excitedly.
Oh, now slow down, Catfish. I'll tell you everything you want to know,
said Bullfrog. They talked. They laughed. They even shed a few tears together. Catfish asked Bullfrog over and over again about Little Brim and how he was getting along. Bullfrog told him how much Little Brim missed him. Their conversation continued well into the night. Bullfrog explained that he had come to the lake to visit a sick friend. He would be leaving soon since his friend had now recovered. Bullfrog, I would give anything if I could go back to the little pond, but I know that that would be impossible, sighed Catfish.
Perhaps not, Bullfrog said as he tried to scratch the top of his head with one of his tiny arms.
But Bullfrog, you yourself know that I can't possibly swim back over the dam, even if the pond is overflowing.
No, I'm doomed to live somewhere other than our little pond.
Well, maybe there is another way. You stay right here and don't wander off, instructed Bullfrog. I have another old friend to see, and I'll be back early tomorrow.
He then sprang from his pad in a flash and disappeared into the moonlit night. Chapter 5. Homeward Bound. As Catfish dozed in the morning light, he became aware of someone calling his name. Looking up, he saw Bullfrog and the biggest bird he had ever seen in his entire life.
Morning, Catfish. I want you to meet Paula Pelican,
said Bullfrog.
Paula, this is Catfish, my friend who has the problem only you can help with.
How do you do? Asked Catfish.
I'm fine, sir, but it sounds like you're not, said Paula Pelican. Are you ready?
Bullfrog asked Paula.
Ready? Ready for what? Catfish asked.
Bullfrog gave Paula the thumbs-up sign. Her big, powerful wings lifted her body from the water. She made a wide loop in the sky, then dove straight toward Catfish. Before he had time to say or do anything, he was scooped up, along with a mouthful of water, and was headed south. Catfish looked down just in time to see Bullfrog wave.
It may take a while, but I'll meet you back at the pond,
Bullfrog shouted happily as he leaped off the lily pad and started his return journey home. Chapter 6. Home is where the heart is. Back at the pond, Little Brim had managed to gather all of Bullfrog's cousins. The tree frogs were beginning to sing and dance the rain dance. Large drops began pounding the surface of the pond, and the water was rising quickly. As the water began gushing over the edge of the dam, Little Brim could wait no longer. He closed his eyes and leaped high into the air. His small body landed not in the stream, but on the grassy bank. Frightened, Little Brim began to flounce around, shouting, "Help! Help me!" From high above, Catfish and Paula Pelican heard the shouts. Catfish looked down at the pond and saw Little Brim struggling.
"Look, Paula!" cried Catfish. "It's Little Brim, and he's in trouble. We have to save him."
"Hang on!"
said Paula, and swooping downward, she scooped him up and made a quick loop in the sky. She then opened her beak real wide and dropped both Catfish and Little Brim head first into the little pond. Catfish and Little Brim were together again. They laughed, they cried, and both promised never to leave the pond again. All who lived in the pond came out to greet and welcome their friends. They persuaded Paula and the tree frogs to remain until Bullfrog returned. Within the week, they all heard a loud croak as the old boy jumped over the dam and landed back on his favorite lily pad.
"Howdy, friends!"
exclaimed Bullfrog, announcing his return. Then the celebration began.
Catfish, Little Brim, Bullfrog, the big-eyed tree frog cousins, and Paula Pelican all sang and danced for several days. Finally, the festivities drew to a close, and the rain stopped, and the tree frogs left. Catfish and Little Brim thanked their new friend Paula for all her help. Then she took off from the water, made a pass back over the pond, and tipped a wing as she headed home. They watched as Paula Pelican flew off into the distance and finally disappeared into the great blue sky. Then Catfish sighed softly and said to Little Brim, "You know, for a long time I was bored with life here, and all I wanted to do was to get away and see the world. But now I realize that life itself is like a long journey. I found that life is the same no matter where you live. It's family and friends you share it with that makes it exciting and special. And another thing I must tell you is that I feel very fortunate to have made it home safely. There were times of danger and loneliness, but through it all I felt that there was someone watching over me and guiding my way. Now the three close friends are together again, spending happy days in the sunlit waters of the little pond. As Catfish tells and retells his tale, old Bullfrog lounges on his lily pad, half listening and half asleep, while Little Brim listens closely to every word. Catfish tells of his encounters with Gasper Goo, Alligator Gar, Paula Pelican, and the many others that are now a part of the legend of Catfish and Little Brim. The end.
Well, that's the story of Catfish and Little Brim. We thought you might also like to know the story behind the story. As we said earlier, this book was written by Ronnie Wells, who is a great artist, a painter, who lives in a place called Salado, Texas. He got the idea for the story from his daughter Tressa, who was 8 years old at the time. It was in the summer of 1975, and Tressa was spending a week with her grandparents. One day, to entertain herself, she created two small characters out of old socks and cotton. She named one of them Catfish and the other one Little Brim. She played with her new friends for quite a while when she was a little girl. Some years after Tressa had grown up, her daddy, Mr. Wells, was thinking about Catfish and Little Brim, and a story about them just sort of popped into his head. So he wrote the story down on paper and painted several paintings to illustrate his book. He called it The Legend of Catfish and Little Brim.